Did any of you have trouble getting here this morning? No, I didn't either, really, seriously. Hi, my name is Aaron Margosis. I'm here to talk about five Sysinternals tools. How many of you attended the Sysinternals primer at TechEd last year or saw it online? Just a handful of you. OK. How many of you are familiar with the Sysinternals utilities? That's why you're here, I guess. OK. So Mark Rasinovich, who is the author of most of the tools, he and Bryce Cogswell, Mark has a session called Case of the Unexplained. And how many of you are already scheduled to go see that later today? It's one of the more popular sessions at TechEd. And in the session, he demonstrates real-world troubleshooting, primarily using the Sysinternals tools. So he goes through real-world problems and solves them using tools like Process Monitor and Process Explorer and things like that. The purpose of this session is a little bit different from that. He goes through troubleshooting processes and how a problem was fixed and things like that. And the purpose of this session is just to talk about the tools themselves and dig into the features of the tools so you can get, rather than just seeing little taste of what these things can do, you can really dive in. And the primary purpose is so that you can go back and use the tools more effectively. So why am I doing this and not Mark? Well, I am the co-author, sort of the Windows Sysinternals Administrator's Reference. This book is coming out real soon. It's just that close. I've been working on it for 2 years. It covers all the tools, all the Sysinternals tools, in great detail, and I made sure I didn't write anything in the book unless I saw it actually work that way. So it's not that it's supposed to work that way, it does work that way, which is part of why it took 2 years. And as you can see, it's by Mark Rasinovich and Aaron Margosis. How many of you have heard the joke I'm about to tell? Because I've told it a lot. Yeah, sorry. It shows the division of labor that was involved, which is basically I wrote all the words in the book while Mark stood over me with a bullwhip saying, faster, boy, faster. And he did write all the tools. So, he's the final author of everything in there. So there's three big chapters in there, one each on Process Explorer, Process Monitor, and Auto Runs. Those are the three primary troubleshooting utilities in the Sysinternals suite. Process Explorer is it's like Task Manager, except it shows you a whole lot more. How many of you are already familiar with Process Explorer? It's basically Task Manager allows you to see, here's what's going on my system right now. Here's the processes that are running. And it allows you to dig deep inside those and see really what's going on with them, what handles they have open, what DLLs are loaded, and things like that. Process Monitor is a logging utility that shows you it captures a lot of very low-level events with a lot of contextual information about each event. So all the file system activity, all the registry activity, every time a process or thread starts or exits, any time a DLL gets mapped into a process address space or another map file gets mapped in, those all get captured. You can save it to a file and send it to somebody else. Or you can have them run a batch file, automate Process Monitor, and produce a log file which they can send to you so you can figure out what happened on their system. Process Explorer and Process Monitor were covered last year in the Sysinternals Primer in New Orleans. Auto Runs will cover this year. We also covered PSExec last year. And then beyond those three chapters, there are chapters about sets of utilities, all about the security utilities, the disk utilities, the network utilities, and so on. How many pages is it? I honestly don't know. I just kept writing and writing and writing until it was pretty much done. So a couple things I want to update you on since the last Sysinternals Primer, which, by the way, if you didn't see the one last year, you can see it online. Go to msteched.com, and sessions from last year are available for on-demand viewing. So a couple things that are new. In Process Explorer, new feature, CPU cycle accounting is one of them. So let me actually pop this up on the demo machine. So Windows has always estimated how much CPU usage was, or how much the CPU was being utilized on a system. Every 15.6 milliseconds, it would check to see what thread is executing on this CPU and then charge that thread 15.6 milliseconds. So it was always an estimate of the actual CPU usage, right? So some threads might get overcharged because if they were running at the instant that that interrupt came in, they'd get charged for a full 15.6. Meanwhile, inside that 15.6 millisecond interval, you might have had a bunch of other threads run and they never get charged at all. So now with Windows 7, starting in Windows Vista, we were able to actually account for CPU cycles, actual CPU cycles charged to every single thread. And with Windows 7, we were also able to do that for interrupts, deferred procedure calls, and so forth. And so now, Process Explorer on Windows 7 or Server 2008 R2 actually shows you the real CPU usage. So the CPU column is actually shows you the percentage of CPU cycles as opposed to the timer-based accounting. And so you may see results that will be different from what Task Manager shows you. Task Manager will still use the timer-based accounting. Another new feature in here is tree CPU usage. So So if you freeze this right here, you should see, if you add up all these numbers, this cycles delta, number of CPU cycles since the last refresh, should match up with the percentages. This is another new feature, is if it is less than 0.1%, it will now say less than 0.1% instead of, you know, rounding down to zero. That was one of the problems with Task Manager, is anything less than 1% shows as zero. The problem with Process Explorer in the past was anything less than 0.1% showed as zero, and now it actually shows that there was some CPU utilization for that process. This other thing here, tree CPU usage, shows you the sum of CPU utilization for that process and all child processes. So if you want to collapse up one of these things, you can still see the sum of the usage for that and its child processes. So that's a new feature in Process Explorer. And back to the slide deck. System information changes. There's a new summary graph that shows all the go back here again. This is a new dialog. Summary graphs of CPU utilization, committed memory system-wide, physical memory usage, I/O, and then new, if you're running with administrative rights, amount of network bytes, the throughput of network, and throughput to the actual physical disk, to local disks. So you have that as a graph as well. And this is pause. Let me continue that up. So that is new in Process Explorer since last year. We also have support. We Microsoft. I'm not really, Mark would never say we and refer to me, but so it goes. Now supports more than 64 CPUs as well. And rather than go through these, because I just showed them to you. Oh yeah, I didn't show this part. Yeah, I showed the summary tab, and then there's separated out CPU, memory, and I/O tabs where you can see the graphs in better detail and then text information below them.
Are you going to publish these slides?
Yes. So question was, am I going to publish the slides? Yes. I've posted them. They will be on the network. I'm sorry for not getting them to you sooner. I finished them at 4 this morning. Did I say it was early for me? I'm up past 3 every day anyway, so. Okay, and there's checkboxes where you can add additional columns to the view for all those. Okay, new in Process Monitor, quick filter context menu. A couple context menu items were added. Just demo those instead. So procmon. Pause that. I've got advanced filtering on. Okay, so one of the things you may want to do is you may want to say, I don't want to see anything before this point. And last year, I showed this demo of how you can set a filter to exclude a single event by timestamp, go into the filter dialog, and then change that to date or time is less than that exclude. And that would be a way to remove everything before that particular point. It's easier now. Mark added exclude events before. So my demo's all shot to heck, you know? And exclude events after. So you can time band these things really easily. Another thing that was added, now you've always had the ability, or at least for a long time, you've had the ability to select multiple rows and copy them. I'm sorry, I'll have your cell phone there, sir. Front row and everything. I'm sorry. I still run the clipboard viewer. And it would copy stuff to the clipboard as tab delimited text, which, you know, can be very helpful. But there's a new feature in Process Monitor where you can right-click on a specific item and say copy just that item. So it copies just that. Now you can take long registry paths and things like that and quickly copy them out of the Process Monitor trace and into something else. I like that feature a lot. Ability to disable individual filter entries. Yes, I guess this was new around that time. Sorry for bouncing back and forth, but you can go in and instead of just removing a filter item completely, you can now temporarily disable it. Right? And then go back in and reapply them without having to reconstruct the entire filter criteria. And finally, an API for developers interested in inserting debug output. So there's debug APIs you can call, and Process Monitor can monitor them, and if you put the right text in, it will show up in the Process Monitor output. So that's useful for developers. For details, buy the book. I'd say go to the web page, but the reason the book is being written is the documentation is, actually, you know what? I bet it's in the CHM file. Don't buy the book. Just get the CHM file. No, I didn't. Did not say that. So here's an example. It shows up debug output profiling, and you can put arbitrary text in there. So you can insert your own events in. What I always used to do is just arbitrarily write to some random registry key with some funky name, and then I could find that in the output. It's like printf debugging. How many of you are developers? Okay, so instead of printf debugging, you can actually do it this way now. Okay, so the tools we're going to talk about today are disk to VHD, autoruns, procdump, bginfo, and access check. How many of you have seen disk to VHD? How many of you love it? Okay, good. Somebody. So this is a fairly new utility. It hasn't been around very long. What it does is it captures the state of the disk using the Windows Volume Snapshot APIs and saves it to a VHD file, a VHD virtual hard drive, which you can then use in virtual PC, Hyper-V, virtual server. I imagine you could boot from a VHD captured this way too. You can? Good. Guessed right. Happens once in a while. There's a command line interface or the GUI. I'll show you the GUI here. The thing that makes it really special is that it can capture a live running system, and most capture utilities can't quite do that. And to reduce the amount of space it consumes, it does not include the paging files or hibernation files. So that saves a lot of space. It works on all supported Windows versions. Note that XP Service Pack 2 is no longer supported. It does require administrative privileges. And you can capture it to multiple places. I recommend putting it on a different spindle if time is of any concern. One additional little bit here is if you're going to capture a Windows XP or Server 2003 system for use in virtual PC, make sure to check the prepare for use in virtual PC checkbox. That does some things to the HAL to make sure the HAL is compatible with virtual PC. And this is one of the simplest demos you'll see. Let me bring up an admin command prompt here. Do you know this trick? You press Shift and Control at the same time, and then click on an icon to get elevation. So I always put the Sysinternals utilities in my path so I can run them from anywhere. Just to VHD. And there it is, very simple. And all you do is point it at a location. I actually don't have a network here, so I'm going to, you know, it's going to time out. I should have just typed it. You type in the path where you want the VHD to go, and you click Create. You'll have multiple volumes to pick from, whatever volumes it finds on the system. Okay, and it'll capture an entire disk, and it'll capture the information in those volumes, the partitioning information. But if I were to uncheck the system reserved, it would still capture that partition, but not any of the data in there. That's basically all there is to it. Done. Well, it's obviously going to take a while, so it's a good thing that I saved one earlier, and I'll show that to you. So let's pretend that this ran through to completion, and I'll go to another machine where I directed it, and now I can attach VHD, go to that location where it is, pick it up. I'll mark it read-only. And there it is. There's my G drive. I can now see the stuff that was
...127 gigs
is the limit if you're going to use it in virtual PC. I don't believe that's a limit for Hyper-V. It's my understanding. Here's the drive from the other system. And I'll show a demo of something you can do with auto runs with that. Any questions about disk to VHD? Does it what? Does it work on an encrypted partition? Great question. It's prizes for making me look foolish. Does it work on encrypted? Where's my pen? That's one to write down. Get me after. If it's BitLocker, yes. Then yeah. If the APIs can see the clear text, you know, the unencrypted, then I would guess it would work. I hate saying I guess. Right, if you're trying to capture an offline system and it's completely encrypted, I would imagine you could capture the encrypted data, but you wouldn't be able to capture clear text. I'm guessing that if it's running on a live system and it has the APIs see it as decrypted. So BitLocker, you would see it would all be in the clear. EFS, depending on the security context that the process is actually doing the reading, if it's running in a context that doesn't decrypt that, then I don't think you'd see the clear text. But that's just a guess.
Can you throttle this utility?
Can you throttle this utility in what sense? So the question is, can you run it in the background at a reduced priority? There's nothing inherent in disk to VHD that would allow you to do that, but you could use Process Explorer to reduce the priority of the process. Actually, I don't think that would be enough. because it's going to be background processes that are doing it. So I would say probably not easily. Actually, let me fire this up again. And we've got Process Explorer running here. Start this thing. We should see some processes starting up. This is the volume shadow copy. And you should see that's probably the one doing the work at this point. So you'd have to throttle that service. Again, just a guess. Question in the back. If you can use the microphones, if you're close to a microphone, it'd be helpful.
It's my understanding from the MDOB team that there's a requirement to have software assurance to use DistDVHD.
So the there is a utility that you can get through software assurance that uses DistDVHD. And what it does, I can't remember the name of the utility. I'm sure they're showing it here this week. It's P2V. And what it does is it captures an XP system into a virtual hard drive and then re-images your machine with Windows 7 and then runs that XP machine in a virtual machine where you can, it works kind of like XP mode, except it's your XP machine instead of the one from Microsoft.com. You do need software assurance and MDOP and that kind of thing to get that, but DistDVHD just by itself does not require, it's free, like all the Sysinternals utilities.
How did you get the yellow bar in Windows Explorer?
How did I get the yellow bar?
The yellow bar,
that is Priv bar, and that's a utility I wrote a number of years ago, and it's on my blog. And it works in Explorer. I wrote it because years ago I was running Windows XP as standard user and then doing some things with admin rights, and I wanted to be able to tell, are my Explorer windows and my Internet Explorer windows running with, you know, user privilege, power user privilege, or admin rights? And so I created that toolbar. And I still run it. And it's on my blog. Yeah. So the question is, are there plans to replace Task Manager in Windows with Process Explorer? None that I'm aware of. None that I've heard of at all. I mean, the thing is that how many people can open Process Explorer and not be completely overwhelmed? Right? It's, you know, we're a tiny part of the population that uses Windows. So it's, I doubt that's going to happen. Okay, so I did mention the three primary utilities for troubleshooting on the Windows platform or, out of the Sysinternals suite are Process Explorer, Process Monitor, and Auto Runs. What Auto Runs gives you is it shows you configuration on the system. It doesn't show you anything about what's actually running. It says, here's what's configured to run automatically. When you log on, when you run Internet Explorer, things that hook into Windows Explorer, things that are configured to run as services, and things like that. It's got a number of benefits over msconfig. One, it doesn't require admin rights. Second, it will show you per user auto start entry points, which msconfig won't do. And there's a lot of those. And quite frankly, malware is starting to abuse those as well. Right? It used to be that they would just write to hkey local machine software Windows current version, software Microsoft Windows current version run. They're going to hkey current user now. And you need to be able to have a way to find those things and remove them. What it does is it looks at what we call auto start extensibility points, or ASEPs. There is a command line version, and you can also analyze offline systems. You can save results and then compare them to, save them as a baseline and then compare them later on. So, demo time. I'm going to switch glasses for this. These are bifocals and aging process. Okay, so this is an admin command prompt. I'm going to run auto runs with standard user rights. Now, a lot of the Sysinternals utilities work with standard user rights, but there's limits to what they can do. So, for example, Let's walk through this a bit. Here's auto runs. You've got 18 different tabs showing all the different categories where everything is, you know, the sum of all the rest of them. Here are the things that happen at logon. Here are the things that hook into Windows Explorer, like context menus, shell extensions, things like that. Internet Explorer, toolbars and browser helper objects, scheduled tasks, things that run in the background based on triggered events, services. Now, one thing you're seeing here is I know I've got a lot more services on my system than this, right? And that's because, by default, it hides Windows entries. You can uncheck that, and it'll show you, and then refresh, and it'll show you all the other ones as well. The thing is, if you look at, for example, what's hooked into Windows Explorer, there's a ton of stuff that's hooked into Windows Explorer, and most of the time you don't care about that when you're trying to troubleshoot a system, because Windows just works. You don't need to worry about what Windows is doing. It's all the other stuff. And so hiding the Windows entries, what that does is anything that has in its file version information, if it says Microsoft in there and it's installed under the Windows folder, it says that's a Windows file, and it will hide those. Okay. You can also choose to hide all Microsoft entries, Microsoft and Windows, and then anything that says it's from Microsoft will be hidden, which might not be a good idea, might not be good enough, depending on what you're trying to find. We'll come back to that. Internet Explorer services, drivers. Now here, there's a whole lot of non-Windows drivers in here, you would think. All this AdaptX stuff, Acer, advanced micro devices. Now here's an interesting thing. Like I just said, we will hide something based on what it says it is, right? It says it's from Microsoft, we'll say, okay, it's from Microsoft. It's really easy to say this thing is from Microsoft. So what you really need to do is verify its digital signature. And verify, is this signed by a code signing certificate that is Microsoft and chains up to an authority that I trust? You can do that on a one-off basis by pressing Control-V or Entry Verify. Now, the interesting thing that happened here is this just changed to Microsoft Windows. And the reason for that is the file version information says Acer, AdaptTech, things like that. It came from a third party, but it was signed with a code signing certificate from the Windows team. So now you can do this across the board, and often this is a good idea. Verify code signatures and run it again. Now, it'll take longer, and you probably will see no drivers in here after that because they're all code signed by Microsoft. But the thing here is this gets rid of or doesn't hide the items that claim to be from Microsoft but aren't signed by Microsoft. While that's spinning. Now, when you verify code signatures, the signing certificates and everything, that takes longer. So just be aware of that. The other things that are in here, codecs, network providers, these seem kind of arcane. But the thing is that they're in there because we've seen malware abuse those points. They are places where third-party software can extend the Windows system, often for good, sometimes for bad. And so those are included in here. And if you see something in there and you verify code signatures and it looks like it doesn't belong, then you may have a problem with that. Yeah, so now go to the Everything tab. A lot more stuff is removed. And the drivers are all Windows. The services, a few services that are not part of Windows, Bing. And both of these are Bing services. Okay, so what else can you do with this? Lots of stuff. So right-click on an item, and you can find out, is this thing running? Go find it in Process Explorer. Right-click, Process Explorer. That's cool. Okay. The reason that's happening is because Process Explorer is running with elevated privileges, and so auto runs is not able to communicate with it. So let me come back to that demo in a little bit after I run this thing with admin rights. So let me come back over here, go to the logon, and show you another feature here. So let's say I've got this Adobe Reader Speed Launcher, and I decide, you know what, I don't want that running all the time. So what I want to do is get rid of it. Now, there's two different ways you can get rid of it. One is you can delete it completely, right? And all you have to do is select and then click delete or hit the delete key, and it will go in and remove that item from the configuration. Now, it doesn't stop the process if it's already running, and it doesn't delete the actual file. All it does is remove the entry that says run this thing, okay? So it's that registry value. So the choices are delete or just temporarily remove by unchecking it. And the problem here is because I'm not running with admin rights, I cannot modify system-wide state. AutoRuns needs to run with administrative rights, and it very, very, very helpfully offers you an elevation. Now I can come back in here and uncheck this. But before I do, let me show you, go back to that other thing, the services, Process Explorer, there. So it jumps to Process Explorer. If Process Explorer were running with standard user rights, that would have worked the first time. And it opens up the properties dialog, get to you in just a second, shows you the properties dialog for that in Process Explorer. Another thing you can do here is right-click and say jump to. Where is this thing configured? And it jumps to the point in the registry where this thing is configured. And the reason I did this is to show you what it does when you disable it rather than delete it. So I clear that and refresh here. It is deleted from the run key. AutoRuns creates a subkey to store what it disabled. So when you log on and Windows Explorer goes through the run key and runs all the commands it finds, it's not looking in the AutoRuns disabled folder. So that thing will not run. But it's really easy to restore that at a later time, just like that. Refresh, and it's back up where it was. There was a question over here. Yes. Right, so when you set the verify code signatures option, the publisher column changes. Without the verification, it shows you what is in the file version information in the executable. With the verify code signatures option enabled, it shows you the name on the code signing certificate. So that executable is signed with a code signing certificate that says Adobe. So the things you'll find in here that are not verified are things that are not signed or things that are signed by a certificate that you don't trust, or there's another problem with the code signature, right? So it may be that it was signed with something that was, where the code signing certificate was out of date at the time of the signature, or it has since gone out of date and the signature wasn't timestamped. So you can have a code signing certificate that expires. As long as the signature itself is timestamped, that signature remains valid, even with an out-of-date code signing certificate. Okay, so other entries in here. Now, like I said, this doesn't stop the process from running, and it doesn't delete the file. To make some of these take effect, you may need to restart a process. You may need to log out and log back in, or you may need to reboot, depending on what it is that you're replacing. So for example, here is Internet Explorer with a Bing toolbar and my toolbar. I can go in and uncheck those toolbars. And of course, it's still there. I have to close Internet Explorer and restart it, and they're gone. So this is a really useful way to find malware that is hooking into Internet Explorer. There's a lot of, browser helper objects are one thing that malware has abused a lot in the past. Another thing that you can do when you're running auto runs with full admin rights is to look at the auto start entry points of other users on the computer. And I have found this to be immensely valuable. So my mother-in-law, right, she's running Windows XP because I don't want to spend the time with her to teach her Windows 7. I don't mind her running Windows XP because she doesn't have a lot of problems with it because she's been running as standard user for a number of years. Okay, so she has two accounts. She uses fast user switching, you know, just the easy tiles on the desk on the login screen. And she logs in with a standard user account to do everything. And then there's an admin account with really ugly wallpaper that says, "Are you sure you need to be here? This is a dangerous place," to do administrative things like install programs and stuff like that. So that by itself used to be enough to block pretty much all the malware out there. But more and more malware is now able to run as standard user, right? Since computers tend to be single user devices, if you can take over one person's account, you've pretty much got that machine. And if they're not clever enough to remove the malware, it's just almost as good as having full control of the system. So they write to HKEY_CURRENT_USER. They drop files in user writable locations. They're doing that more and more. And it happened to her. I think it was probably because out of date flash player or something like that. I don't know. I got a call. I had to go over. And it was really easy. All I had to do is I verified. I log in as her, and there's this screen saying, your antivirus is out of date, and there's all these infections, and you need to pay us X amount of money. Give us your credit card information, and we'll clean everything up. I said, yeah, right. Logged out, logged in as the admin account, ran auto runs, and went to the user menu, and picked the other user, her user account. And oftentimes, that will be enough to find obvious malware. If it were that easy. But you see here, this is running in the other user account's HKEY_CURRENT_USER, in their part of the registry. That's where it's being triggered from. So from here, it's very easy to jump to this location. Now, if I jump to this location here, this is an HKEY_CURRENT_USER for a different user, and AutoRuns knows that. So right-click, jump to, and it goes to HKEY_USER's SID, Software Microsoft, et cetera. So it's the HKEY_CURRENT_USER of a different user, and it jumps to the correct location. And from here, I can see additional, well, there's no additional details here. It's just obviously malware. There should be a law that if you're going to write malware, you should make it really clear. How about rootkits? Great question. So can AutoRuns find rootkits? If you're talking about kernel mode rootkits, which are the primary form of rootkits, what that does is it makes the system no longer Windows, right? There's a contract that if a program calls this particular API, this API will return this information about the system, right? What a rootkit does is it causes that contract to be null and void. It says, I'm not going to show you these registry keys or these user accounts. I'm going to hide them from you, or these files. So you do a directory listing. It will insert itself in the chain and not allow you to see those things. AutoRuns depends on standard documented Windows APIs to see all the stuff that's going on in the system. So it can lie to AutoRuns and you won't see it. What you can do, though, what a great tie-in, is the thing is a rootkit really only works when the system is running, right? If you take it offline and look at it offline, it's not running. It can't hide. So it would be great if only AutoRuns had the ability to analyze offline systems. So that VHD. File, analyze offline system. You point it to, here's the Windows directory of that system that's not running right now, and the user profile I want to look at. and it'll look at the auto start entry points of that system. So I can promise you I do not have Sun Java on my system. It's only on that virtual machine, because that virtual machine doesn't matter to me. I wouldn't run Java on a system that I cared about. Logo. And here, back here, there's the chip that they inserted. So that's Analyze Offline System. Another thing you can do is, question? Does it run under Windows PE? As a matter of fact, yes. And I've done that to get control back of systems as well. Question. Is it part of Dart? It's free. Okay, so Dart is the Diagnostic and Recovery Toolkit, and I believe a lot of that stuff came originally from Mark and Bryce's company. When we acquired Sysinternals, and Winternals, and I believe Dart included a lot of that. They may have had some functionality. To be honest, I really don't know the answer. But AutoRuns is free. Can you run it on a remote machine? Kind of. I mean, you won't see the GUI, but what you can do is run the command line, psexec auto run command line. And in the deck, which will be on the network here, I promise, there's all the details of what you can put in the command line. So you run that and save it to a .arn file. In fact, I was just about to show that you can save this to a .arn file, and then you can use that as a baseline compared against other systems. So I already have one there that I saved earlier, so I'll do file, compare, and compare to my baseline, and it'll show you here's what's changed since then, since you captured that baseline. Okay, so after I did the capture, I set up a auto start for Zoomit and for PrivBar. Okay, any other questions? Because I've got about half an hour left to go through three more utilities. Okay, a question over here. Yeah. So the request is to do a remote GUI, yeah. Ask Mark. I have no control over that. I tell you, actually, you know what I could do, though? You know, the book is going to be perfect. There's not going to be any mistakes in the book. And if it turns out that there's any differences between the book and the actual utilities, I'm going to make him fix the utilities to match what the book says. So what I can do is add that remote GUI capability into the book and then make him put it into the... I'll see if I can get away with that and keep my knees intact. Actually, he's too tall to reach my knees anyway. And he always tells me how short I am, but. Okay, back to here, proc dump. Okay, so, you know, AutoRuns obviously is one of those big troubleshooting tools where you can solve a lot of problems, and I've fixed a number of systems just by bringing up AutoRuns and finding configuration. ProcDump is a bit more of a specialized tool. Doesn't apply to as many people. And what it does is it allows you to capture a process dump, a user mode process dump. What's a process dump? It captures the state of a process at a particular point in time and captures information about that, including what threads were in there, what modules were loaded, the state of memory, depending on the type of dump you get. There's different kinds of dumps you can capture. There's a utility that's been out there for a while called AD Plus. This is a lot easier to use. And you can configure proc dump to capture a dump upon a number of different trigger events. Okay, so you can point it at a process and say, capture a dump right now. Just capture the state of it right now. Or capture it if the CPU or memory usage goes above a threshold, or if the GUI hangs for a certain amount of time, or if there's an exception, if an exception is triggered in there, second chance, unhandled exception, capture the state of that to a dump file in a location that I choose so that I can analyze it or send it to someone else to analyze. Or you can do it that for first chance exceptions as well, or breakpoints, or termination. Sometimes a process just terminates. No exception, it just says, I'm out of here. You can capture, at the time that it goes to terminate, what the state of that thing was and try to find evidence of why it happened. And in more recent versions of ProcDump, you can use perfmon counters, performance monitor counters, to set thresholds and say, if this perfmon counter exceeds this level, capture a dump. There are three types of dumps. There's mini dumps. Actually, let me go through the syntax here. And I'll talk about the different dump types. So here's the command line syntax, very simple, easy to memorize. So first of all, you run procdump and you say, monitor this process. And you can do that by specifying the process name or the process ID. If there's multiple instances of that process, like just the common example, Notepad, that's just the easy one. Like, of course, Notepad always gives you trouble in production, so you're always having to capture information about Notepad. If there's multiple instances of Notepad, then you can't use the process name. You have to use the process ID. It has to be something that is unique. And then you specify the name of the dump file optionally. If you don't specify the name of the dump file, it will just use the image name, so Notepad, for example, as the base name, append a timestamp to it, and then .dmp. With -x, you can say, start this process and start monitoring it. So instead of monitoring something that's already running, you can say, start this process and monitor it from the beginning. So if it's having problems early in the process, you can launch it using procdump. The criteria, like I said, we got CPU utilization, and you can make that system-wide or equivalent to a single CPU. I'll demo that in a little bit. Number of seconds, -s says how long does this criteria need to be met before we capture the dump? N, how many dumps? So with a combination of -s and -n, you can say when it hits this criteria, capture 3 dumps 5 seconds apart. And there have been cases where we've had our engineers, it's like a really quick little thing, and they'll capture a series of dumps and look in each of them for the evidence, because sometimes the evidence isn't in the first one, it might be in the third one. M is for committed memory. If the process's committed memory exceeds a certain point, trigger dump. -h is for a hung UI. -e is for exceptions. -b says include breakpoints in that as well. -t is if it terminates, and -p for performance counters, perfmon counters. The type of dump, if you don't specify anything, it gives you just a mini dump, which is process and thread information, minimal memory information. If you specify -ma, it's a full memory dump, all the committed memory in the process, which can be very big. So because some of these can be really, really big, especially if you're trying to debug something on, say, Exchange server, the store.exe process is a huge amount of memory. And if you try to capture that, it'll spend a lot of time writing to disk. And then if you try to send that to somebody, you know, it's really painful. So along with, I can't believe I'm blanking on his name, Andrew. He'll kill me. So Exchange escalation engineer named Andrew Richards came up with the idea of a mini plus dump, which is a mini dump with additional information. And it uses heuristics to determine what parts of memory do we want to include in the dump. We don't need to include the image of store.exe itself in that. We don't need to include lots of read-only memory. So it's primarily read-write memory that gets captured in addition to what normally gets captured in a mini dump. The result is a much smaller dump, but a much more effective one. That, you know, even 90% smaller than a full dump, but enough information to handle most debugging needs. One caveat, don't do it with .NET processes. It doesn't work well with .NET. -r is reflection, and I'll just demo that. -o says don't overwrite or do overwrite a previously existing file, which doesn't matter. Most of the time, procdump will timestamp the file, you know, put a timestamp in the name of the output file. And -64 says if you're on a 64-bit system and you're capturing a dump of a 32-bit process, by default, it'll just capture a 32-bit dump. This says capture a 64-bit dump. Okay, so here is my production system. And this is the app that I'm having problems with. It has problems with memory and hanging and hogging CPU and stuff like that. I think the button CPU hog is kind of a giveaway, but let's say we don't know that. So let's bring up, and this works as long as you're monitoring something that doesn't have admin rights. You can do it with standard user rights. Okay, so proc dump, the name of the executable is vertmemtest. Okay, it just captures the dump right away. Now I can run windebug, and that dump file, and open it, and see the state of the process. Now what proc dump will do is add a comment in here saying, you know, first of all, what was the command line that was executed, what the proc dump command line was, and what was the reason for capturing the dump. So here it was just capture dump right away. Note that it does not terminate the process. Okay, it just captures the state of that process. You can specify an alternate file name to write to, an alternate base name. Okay. Get rid of those. And you can capture a series of dumps. Proc dump dash N3 dash S3. Three dumps 3 seconds apart. Two and three. Now let's do some CPU stuff. Proc dump C, let's do 80%. And exceed 80% for 2 seconds. That should be enough. Right, and vertmem test. Okay, so now it's waiting. It's waiting for this process to exceed 80% CPU for 2 seconds, and then just capture one dump to this location. So I have a button here which will spin the CPU, bring up Process Explorer, so we can see what happens. Start spinning the CPU. It launched a thread which is doing nothing but executing. Spin, 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 execute code. But it's only getting up to around 50% because it's a dual proc system. A single thread that's gone runaway can only take up the equivalent of one CPU. And on a dual proc system, that's half of the CPU available. So it'll never reach that 80%. So what I can do instead, press Control C to say stop monitoring the process. Add a dash U, and it says scale that to the number of CPUs on the system. Okay, so you can see smaller spikes. So on a 32 proc system where it's, you know, one CPU can only get like 3-some% of the system. Can't stop that thread. So this will say the equivalent of 80% of one CPU. Oops. Oh. I just terminated the process by accident. Start it again. Okay, that time it captured it. DBG Z, that's the last one. There's the command line. Process exceeded 80% CPU. The thread consuming the CPU is this one. It'll set the context to that thread. So that when it comes back, I can eventually look at the call stack and see exactly what piece of code it was executing at that time. It's taking a little while, so there it goes. Okay, so KVN. And there it is. There's the call stack, and you can see it's inside this thing called CPU hog thread. Let me do another one where it crashes. Let's do a proc dump E burp mem test. Okay, so now it's looking for exceptions. And so what I'm going to do to trigger that is I'm going to allocate some read-write memory, and then I'm going to execute it. So this is going to be a DEP violation, a data execution prevention. Okay, and now it's going to crash, and dbgz, that one. So now because it's a crash, I can do an analyze-v and do some basic triage and figure out why did this thing crash. And there's all the information. Very quickly, this thing crashed because of an NX fault. NX is no execute, equivalent to data execution prevention. Tried to execute code from a non-executable part of memory. And you can see here, this function called into some piece of memory that isn't assigned to a DLL or an EXE, and it crashed. Okay, start up vertmem test again, because we don't quit. Okay, so memory dumps. So proc dump. Now, let's take a look at these. All of these were mini dumps, and they're all, in this particular case, you know, around 360K. Okay, if we do a full dump of, and let's set a commit, if it exceeds 500 meg, we're going to dump the process. And it's not WinDebug I want to run, it is proc dump. And I will allocate 500 meg, free it afterwards so I don't leak. And let's bring up process monitor at the same time so we can see exactly what's going on here. Here's vertmem test. Here's the process. Allocates. Process is suspended while the dump is being captured. This is a big one. And you can see that took a while. And this is a little tiny program. Imagine capturing store.exe, you know, exchange server on a big system. That takes down your system for a while. So there's an option. Oh, and let's take a look at the size of that. 571 meg, right? It's capturing all of the virtual, you know, committed virtual memory of that process. So there's an option to use reflection. This is a new feature in Windows 7 Server 2008 R2. It says when you use reflection, it clones the process and then captures a dump of the clone instead. So let's just do it and see what happens this time. Now here's vertmem test. Keep an eye on that. Allocate the memory. Bang. It wrote the first dump file. It created a new process, cloned it. This one's still running. I can interact with this thing while it's capturing the rest of the information. Let's take a look at the results of that. Here are the three files it created. Vertmem test reflected dump. This is the big file. This is the virtual memory. This is the main dump file. This has process and thread state, register state, things like that. And then there's this INI file, which ties the two of them together. And it's the INI file that you use to that you open in WinDebug. You just treat it like a dump file, and it opens the two of them. Okay, so the benefit here is using Server 2008 R2, you can capture a dump of the thing without tying up that process. It can continue to run while you're still capturing the dump. Question came up last time I did this presentation, does that require duplicating that much memory? And the answer is no. It makes that memory copy on write. So as long as that portion of memory is not modified, it will not incur any additional data cost or memory cost. If something writes to it, it'll copy just that memory, and so you will have that little bit of incremental difference. But the thing is here, this is still a really huge file. So let's take a look at the third option, which is to use mini plus, and I'm going to do it without reflection. Okay. Run that. Allocate that memory again. Bang, bang, done. In this case, 649. The heuristic said, you know, there's 500 meg that have been allocated, but most of it, heuristically, we can look at and say we don't really need to worry about that. And so it captures the memory it feels will be important for debugging and just captures that. OK, any questions about proc dump? Is this useful for any of you in here? OK, good. Glad it's helpful to somebody. Sorry again? OK, two processes crashing at the same time, you would have to monitor both at the same time. You'd have to run two separate instances. Proc dump can only monitor one process at a time. So you could run multiple instances of proc dump. So the question is, can you use it basically proactively? Like when this process runs, I want to monitor it with proc dump. You might be able to do something with image file execution options. There's a way you can hook it into AE debug so that it comes in as the crash handler. If a process crashes, you can configure proc dump to be the handler for it and capture a dump. Those are a couple ways. Question? So the question is, if you open the dump file in Visual Studio and you have the source code, will it show the source code? I've never opened the dump file in Visual Studio. I imagine it could. WinDebug will. I know the WinDebug, if you've got the source code on the system, you know, you've got the symbol files, obviously. If you have the source code that goes along with it, it will open up the source code automatically. So I imagine Visual Studio would too. OK, BG Info. Who's familiar with this one? You use it a lot? OK, so this is not a diagnostic or troubleshoot. Well, it's kind of diagnostic. What it does is, its primary purpose is take system configuration information and put it in your wallpaper. So you can just walk up to a system, look at the wallpaper, and see a bunch of information about it. And that can be really useful. If you're managing a lot of different computers and you want to know which one this is, that's a good thing to have. Lots of flexible formatting available. There's a bunch of default fields that you can insert into the wallpaper, and then you can create your own custom ones as well. You can create, just say, read this thing out of the registry and put it on the, in the wallpaper. Environment, values of environment variables, results of WMI queries, VB script output, arbitrary text files, put those in there. You can also log the results to a database or to a CSV file. Here's a screenshot of what it might look like. So it can integrate with your existing image, your existing wallpaper, or some other thing like that. OK, let's see. Get rid of that. OK, BG info. So you run BG info. And all the Sysinternals utilities, since this wasn't a problem before we acquired them, Mark Rusinovich's company didn't have a gigantic legal department. Microsoft does. And you cannot run a product from Microsoft without accepting the end user license agreement. Now, you must read the entire thing and understand it before you click agree. Or I'm going to decline this right this time, because there's another way to do it. I don't need admin rights for this one. Bring up a new command prompt. BG info. Most of the utilities will accept this slash accept EULA option, which says, automatically go through. Now, for BG info, since it's primarily interactive, it's not really a big deal. But if you're using automated tools like PSExec, or you want to run auto runs on a remote system using PSExec. If you don't accept the EULA in the security context of the end user who's running it, so it's a per user thing, right? You run PSExec auto runs and run it as local system on some other box, local system has to approve the EULA. So you need to run auto runs space accept EULA on the remote system. Otherwise, this dialog is going to pop up in a non-interactive context, and it will hang. So accept EULA's, yeah. You can thank our legal department. Geniuses. How do I get away with this and not get fired? I see a question over here. So the question is that just a registry key somewhere? And actually, I'm going to do it in PowerShell, because PowerShell is wicked cool. So CD to H key current user, software, Microsoft, no, not Microsoft. Yeah, no. Software, sysinternals, do directory listing, and we'll look at access check, which will come up a little bit later, and look at what's in there. And there is a value called EULA accepted, and it's set to a value of 1. Okay, so that typically is what works. So I'm not saying you should do this, but you could take a .reg file and just import it in that has all the EULA accepted. You could. In theory, it would be wrong, but you could do it. Okay, let me start this again because there was something I wanted to point out, and that is that you see this, it's counting down the number of seconds. If I don't do something, click something on here before that thing times out, it will take that configuration and apply it to the wallpaper. So that's not really what I want. So here is, default information, and this is just a great big rich text editor, and you can just modify stuff in here and put arbitrary text in, like this, and you can set the font size, not big enough, still not big enough, it's getting there, and set the color on it too, right? Did I set that? Yes, right? Now, the thing is, you have arbitrary text in here, and then you have these things inside the angle brackets. The thing inside the angle brackets will be replaced with corresponding values. So boot time is understood to be when the system was booted up. CPU is information about the CPU. You can add custom content, like I said. So let's say you want the BIOS version. So I'll call it BIOS version. And we'll make it a WMI query, and we'll make it select, I think this is it, BIOS version from Win32 BIOS. I think that's correct. Anybody know for sure? So now, this gets added to the list of fields I have available. I can click on that, set an insertion point here, and add it. Now let's say I don't need to keep this text here. I can just remove that and just leave this here. Now, how do I know whether that's correct? I can do a preview and see what this is going to look like. Yeah, so I got the BIOS version out of here. Okay, so there's lots of additional stuff you can add in. Other things you can do, you can set the background to copy the existing wallpaper settings or pick another bitmap. So for example, I might go to, let's see, that looks good. Okay, we'll use that as the background. Or you can use different background colors, just solid colors. And let's do the preview again. Preview is still on. Or is it? No. Oh, dear. Oh, yes. You have to set the wallpaper position. So let's do center. Okay, there we go. Ah. No, that's missing something. Cancel that. I don't like that. Okay, so something that used to be really valuable here is this desktops feature. Now, you can specify, apply it to the user desktop and or apply it to the logon desktop. So you don't have to log on to see this stuff. You can just walk up to the system. No one's logged in. You can see the wallpaper. That works, that continues to work in XP and Server 2003, but I think it was the marketing department made this call that the wallpaper on the logon screen must be, you know, left pristine. So in Windows Vista, the only way to modify the logon wallpaper is to modify or replace a signed Windows DLL, and then you're totally unsupported. In Windows 7, they backed off from that. There are ways to do it, but it's a brand new way, and BG Info has not been updated to take advantage of that. So what is the value of this is you may want to say, okay, user desktop, don't update this wallpaper. Do not alter the wallpaper at all. So why would you do that? Because perhaps you want to save it to something else, such as to a database. You can write it to a SQL database. So all the information, both the default fields and the custom fields, you can have that all written to a SQL database, and the book will have the information about exactly what the permissions are in the tables and things like that. Or you can write it to a file. So, for example, I'll write it to the documents folder, BG info information. And the choices are a database file, an MDB file, Excel spreadsheet, and it'll base it on you know, what the extension is. And I'll just make it a .txt file. And it'll make a comma delimited text file. Create a new database record for every run, or so that'll append to the existing information. And so if I click apply, it'll take this information, or the fields anyway, and write it to this file. So BG information, there it is, comma delimited text with headers. And it includes the BIOS information that I added, the custom fields. And if I click apply again, it will add yet another record. So this is pretty powerful. You can capture all this information about the system, so you don't need to buy System Center anymore. How about that? Powerful stuff. OK, so I think that's basically the tour of BG Info. I've got 2 minutes to talk about access check. Beg your pardon? How do you turn it off? Oh, OK. So yeah, I guess I will spend the rest of the time talking about BG Info. Or we'll stay late. Anybody want to stay another 2 hours? Because I've got lots of material. All right. So all you have to do is once you apply this, one thing I forgot to point out is there's a command line interface. So you can save this information. Thank you. I can see it. It works on my machine. So you can save this to a BGI file, myconfig.bgi. OK, and actually, let me go back before I forget. And we're not writing it to the database. So let's clear that out. And let's do update the user wallpaper. OK, save that to this BG file. Close this. OK. BG info, that BGI, if I run that, it opens up that file. And 10 seconds later, it will apply it. Or add timer, and then how many seconds before that down counter expires. Timer 0 applies it right away. OK. So what you can do is you create a BGI file and then put an auto start entry point in the run key or the startup folder or something like that that runs BG info, timer, et cetera. And it will update every time you log on to the computer. Good question. Thank you. So then it applies. It stopped running. See, so it's not running now. It ran timer 0, applied the wallpaper. It's not executing. It's just that's the wallpaper now. If I go into personalize, this is my wallpaper. Is it showing? There it is. Yeah, so this is my wallpaper. It saves it as an image file, and that's my wallpaper. So if you want to restore it back to what it was, you just go in and pick some other wallpaper. Yeah, sorry about that. OK. Access check. All right. I've got 14 seconds left. I'm going to run over. Those of you who want to leave can leave. I won't be terribly offended. Just fill out the evals and all that kind of stuff. Do get the deck, because the back of the deck has tons of information about all the command line options with descriptions, tables, and everything like that. That said, now I'm 36 seconds over, and we're going to talk about access check. If you want to stick around, please do. I'll keep it to 5 minutes. So what access check does by default is show you the effective permissions on system objects. So how many of you are familiar with iCackles? Right? And how do you like how well it tells you what the permissions are in the registry? Right? It doesn't. It only shows you stuff in the file system. Access check allows you to see permissions on file system objects, registry objects, or any other securable object, just about any other securable object in the system. Windows names, object manager, namespace objects, and so forth. It shows by default effective permissions, which is not necessarily like this user account. Let me just demo this too. So let's look at open up folder and search options, unhide documents and settings. Let's look at the documents and settings folder in the root of the C drive. It's a junction that points to another location. So the idea with effective permissions is there's permission, there's a deny for everybody that denies the ability to list. There's an allow for everyone's system administrators. Well, what does that do for the user named Abby? Well, let's go to effective permissions, select Abby, and these are the effective permissions for Abby. Now, this is just kind of an estimate. Okay, there are bugs in the implementation or things where it's just impossible to tell certain things. But here, it's basically showing almost full control, but not list. So these are the effective permissions for Abby. Well, what about the permissions for Toby, who's a standard user on this computer? And it's a whole lot less. Traverse, read extended, and read permissions, but not list. So these are the effective permissions, right, for a particular user. So access check, and it's best to really run access check with full admin rights most of the time. Okay, this thing is bugging me. I'm going to hide that red light if I can. I don't want to look at it. All right. That's not going to work. Thank you. Always the easiest solutions. So there's this documents and settings junction. You have to do /A to see it. Access check. D says, show me permissions on this directory. Don't list the contents of the directory. Documents and settings. So basically, approximately read permissions for everyone, read write for system administrators. So this is just, you know, a gross, like, are there any write permissions for everyone? No, there aren't. So what does that do for Abby? Read-write. What does that do for Toby? Read-access. Okay. So if you want to see the actual permissions, though, then you use, or if you want to see the details, -dv. Okay. So these are the actual This is the actual access control list on the object. And you can also see things that you can't see with iCackles, such as here are the permissions on the root of C, okay, which you can do with iCackles. But here is the volume. The volume object. The permissions on the volume are separate from that of the folder. Not the same. And volume permissions can come into play for operations you may want to perform on a volume instead. You can use this to look at process permissions. So by specifying -p and the name of the process, or the actual access control, this is running at high integrity and grants access only to administrators and system. You can use this to search for permissions. So for example, let's look for where does users have write permissions under the Windows folder. So we do access check. W says look for write permissions, any type of write permissions. Append file, append create folder, whatever. Do a recursive search with S and Windows. Oops, I forgot to mention users. So yeah, that'd be a problem. Do a CLS here. And then run access check looking for permissions for users in the Windows folder. So there's a few places where users have some write permissions. The temp folder is an interesting one. Standard user can create files in there, but they can't list the content. And they can only access stuff that they themselves created. So it's kind of a weird one. If standard user goes into the temp folder, they can go in there. If they do a directory listing, they see nothing, not even the files that they created. So they have to know the name of the file. And you can do searches in the registry. So there's this group called Network Configuration Operators, right, that has some ability to perform system-wide operations. So where does it have permissions in the registry? Access check dash K says this object that we're looking at is a registry key. Do a recursive search. Look for write permissions. U says ignore errors, because there may be some access denieds in here. And for the network configuration operators group. And the object that we want to look into is hkey-local machine system current control set. And it will recurse throughout the registry looking for things where network configuration operators has write permissions. And there are all these network-related things. So you can look for access permissions really effectively using access check. Okay, I did say 5 minutes, and it's sort of 5 minutes. So the deck has lots of information about website features, where you can get information about new releases and updates. Mark's blog, my blog, I publish my own utilities too. And at the end of this deck, a whole lot of command line syntax and descriptions of all the options that you can run. Question over here. WMI objects. You can do, so there is a utility called WinObj. Thank you, everybody. I'll stay up here and take questions until they kick me out. And for good questions, I still have some sticks to give out because I kind of forgot that I had them here. So yeah, that was good enough. That was good. Here you go. They're sticks. They're power. You can power up small birds and things. Question.